As you can see in the title here, I added one more word, INSAR. This is because if you map the water, it's always you want to have a good map and always have two components. Could be a surface water, but if you have flooded vegetation, you also want to map the flooded vegetation as water too. The project is it was for the Public Health of Canada because they wanted to see how the water evolves in the wetlands and link it with the microbial development that they were interested in. So this is the test area here. This is in Brockville, close to the Thousand Lakes in Ontario. And it is a wetland, but there is also some forest here. And from the image, you can obviously see the surface water here. And you can guess a little bit that this could be a flooded vegetation, but you never know if it's in that moment if it's flooded or not. And also here is a forest, but again, is the dry forest? Is there water at the base of the forest? And optical imaging doesn't answer these questions, but the radars can do that. So first, I started with my first fieldwork trip, and I went to install some water level loggers into the water. I inspected a little bit of forest around, and I saw that there is a lot of water at the base of the forest. You cannot see it optically, even from 2-3 meters, you cannot see anything. But I can assure you, if you step in, it's going to be like half meter of water under the vegetation. So the question is, how do you map this as water? As water, and not as a forest or something else. I kept going around off the wetland towards the airport. There's an airport there, and there are a lot of places which are very vegetated. But once you walk in, your feet are getting into the vegetation, and you see the footprint. The moment I step out, it's filling up with water. So again, an optical image wouldn't see this as water, it would see it as the vegetation. Now this is the same area here, I just extended a little bit towards the airport and behind the airport here. Again, here we see just a forest, just a vegetation, a green color. Here we might guess a little bit of water here, but by the way, these are two images, one in winter, one in the summer. So you see this border here because of the different dates. But with radar, first of all, so these are two radar images combined into an interferogram. The colors are from the phase fringes. And suddenly, if you look at the radar, you see that something happens here, which is not visible here. And of course, the wetland and this part, which you can guess, but also you have this the forest here, which you wouldn't guess there's water here from the optical image. So from this image, suddenly you can map this as a water, but also this is water here, and this is water here, and this is water here under the vegetation. So a real water extent map will include not only this part, as usual is done with the optical images. It's going to include the whole thing, here, there, little bit, there and there. So why is this happening? Why do we have this nice pattern seen from radar? How come we have information from radar there? And we don't have any information on the dry forest, which is just not coherent, it's just a random phase. Well, what happens here, this is from Brian's presentation before, one of the images. I did some additions here to that one. So if you are into the flooded forest or maybe a wetland with different vegetation but with water at the base of it, what happens with the radar is that it's going through the vegetation, hits the water, and hits the bigger trunks and going back. And now imagine that we have multiple of, you have the wavefront of the radar, so you have multiple hits. This is one hit, but then you have another hit here of the water and so on. And they all sum up in one pixel. And because there are so many of them, they're coherent. So you can exploit the phase of the signal to extract this path. Now, what we measure here are two points. Is the water level change here in the vertical direction, because this is the point where it hits the water. So if this point is moving up and down, it's going to affect the radar phase. And the second point is the horizontal movement of the tree, right? But the tree doesn't move horizontally, right? So basically, this is always going to be a zero, close to zero phase. And what we actually measure is the vertical movement of the water. Now I was grouping the images in two sets. One is an early data set in the spring, and the vertical, the incidence angle is much steeper than on the second data set. And because the incidence angle is steeper, we have more penetration of the radar microwave to the vegetation, and then more chances to get to the water surface and go back. So with these images, we can easily see the water development, water extent at every date. So we can easily map this by a low amplitude threshold for the surface water here and the high amplitude threshold for the double bounce water. Put them together and we have a water extent map combined from surface and from the vegetation. Later on, I had to change the incidence angle because I've been in a conflict with Agriculture Canada. So I was forced to go with a shallow incidence angle, 42 degrees. And what happened, everything disappeared. So now, because of the path to the ground is too long, and the radar doesn't really hit the water. So it's very important, the geometry of acquisition. So steep, you get the water. Shallow, you don't get it. But now I wasn't sure if this is because of the geometry or maybe the water dried up. So I went again into the field and went to the forest, and it's all wet. So that means that there is the water is there, but the geometry is not good for this site in order to detect the water. And this is a different field work when in the fall. Now it dried up in August, September. Okay, so for the steep incidence angles, I created the interferograms, and of course, if we see the bright pixels into the image, we're going to also have coherence into the interferograms in the same spot. But there's one more thing that we can extract from here. We can see those fringes here. So what do they mean? So basically, what happens here is there's an inflow of water from this direction, and the water is pushed that way. So every time when you get an inflow or an outflow of water, depending of what happens on the ground, it takes time for that water level change to propagate towards the end of this marsh. And this time means that the water levels are different. The water is not flat. And you can actually measure the water level difference in space. So for example, we have a red fringe, a red fringe, red fringe. Between those two red fringes, we have a 2.8 centimeters of water level change. So in the little marsh, this is maybe 5, maybe 1 kilometer max, we have at least 10 centimeters of water level change. So the water is not like that, it's like that. And from this point to this point, we have a 10 centimeters water level difference. But this is important because most of the time in hydrology, people assume flat water, and then you calculate the volume of water, and it's not going to be very, very accurate. The same thing with the steep incidence angles. We are losing all the information on the marsh and in the flooded forest. We are kept only with the sparse vegetation just around the wetland and the open surface. So this is the difference. So with our optical image or with this image, our map is going to show only this part with water. With the right incidence angle, our map is going to show a lot of water, right? And this is the real answer. And now I zoomed into the wetland here, and of course, if we want to do a water extent map on this one, it's going to be the black thing from open surface, and I'm going to add to the map all these high coherence areas, which are also water. And then I looked into each area separately to see what else can I extract from this map here, this interferogram. So I went here, I went there, I went here and there, and see what's on the ground. And when I zoomed here in, and I also went to the field work there, I saw a gradient of phase from this flooded vegetation where the surface water easily penetrates this part, and basically the water levels are the same, towards the shallow water, maybe maybe mud, maybe a highly saturated soil. And so I went there and I checked it out, and indeed this was a muddy water, and this was just the flooded vegetation. So you can also, with from the phase of the interferograms, we can kind of detect the border between the surface water penetrating the vegetation and then the gradient from surface water to mud and to dry areas. And this is very important for public health in Canada, because in these areas you have all the microbial population developing, and this is of interest for them. On the southwest corner of the wetland, I looked closer, and I also saw this gradient here. So we have this constant phase related to the water level change into the surface water, and but here is different. Doesn't fit the pattern. So I followed this up the stream, and this is a different water body. And I went to the field, and I found out that there's a beaver dam here. And basically, the water flows from the higher part to the lower part in this way. So basically, using interferograms, I find out the connection between two water bodies, and I found out when it's flowing and how it's flowing. From optical photos, we cannot say that. It's all green. There's no difference. You can only guess that there might be a connection if you look at the high resolution images, but you cannot find the dynamics as in the radar case. The same thing here. I'm going to show more of this tomorrow at the seminar. But basically, I was intrigued by this gradient here from the upper surface, high coherence and heavy gradient, and no coherence here. Here is nothing in the radar data. And it turns out that we can map this as open surface. Then we have a flooded vegetation. Then we have the high moisture soil and mud, and then we have the dry area. So for whoever wants to know at any moment in time how these borders are varying from open surface to high saturated soil, from saturated soil to dry soil, you can do that using INSAR. The same thing here. The more you go towards the shore, the more shallow water and muddy soils we find, like this.